بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما إن الذين يؤذون الله ورسوله لعنهم الله في الدنيا والآخرة وأعد لهم عذابا مهينا والذين يؤذون المؤمنين والمؤمنات بغير ما اكتسبوا فقد احتملوا بهتانا وإثما مبينا صدق الله العظيم.
Shukla Imam Shehab. So thank you again for joining us for today's session. We are doing the fifth session of Inspiring Muslim Minds. We have some sisters joining us upstairs as well. The audio reaches upstairs, so if you feel more comfortable up there, you'll be able to hear from there as well. I wanted to start off by saying Inspiring Muslim Minds is an educational initiative that we started, that was started by the Muslim Medical Association of Canada. The website for the MMAC is up there, and you can see other events that we hold as well in case you're interested in going to the other events. We have them at various masjids, community centers. I recognize some faces here of people who have been here before. And really, the MMAC is a platform for Muslim physicians to contribute to the betterment of our society and our communities here. So just to begin by introducing our panel members. So we have a really great panel. We have Dr. Shabbir Alibhai. Dr. Alibhai completed his medical school training in 1993, and he went on to specialize in internal medicine and geriatrics medicine. He then obtained a master's in clinical epidemiology, and he did all these degrees at U of T. He's currently on staff as a geriatrician and researcher at the UHN, and is a research scientist of the Canadian Cancer Society. He is an associate professor in the Department of Medicine and the Institute of Health Policy Management and Evaluation at the University of Toronto. And it's really great to have him join us for this topic because he does have a long-standing personal and educational interest in religious biomedical ethics, and he focuses on end-of-life issues and also comparative bioethics. He's lectured both internationally and published articles and book chapters on Islamic and comparative religious biomedical ethics, as well as artificial nutrition and hydration. He has been featured in multiple media interviews and is a local expert on Islamic bioethical issues. And his primary research interest is in cancer in older adults. So I'm really glad to have Dr. Alibhai here with us today. We also have Dr. Al-Awamer, who is a palliative care physician. He works at the Princess Margaret Center in Toronto. He earned his Bachelor of Medicine, a Bachelor of Surgery degree from King Faisal University in Saudi Arabia. And he did his medical residency training in family and palliative medicine at the University of Toronto. Dr. Al-Awamer completed a master's in health sciences degree in bioethics at the University of Toronto, so really great to have him here for this panel. It's very pertinent. He has delivered conference papers nationally and internationally, and his research interest is actually specifically in end-of-life Islamic ethics and global palliative care promotion. Lastly, but not least, we have our new imam from Masjid Toronto, so Imam Dr.Wael Shehab. He has his PhD in Islamic Studies, mashallah, from Al-Azhar University. He was a Sharia consultant of the Sharia department of onislam.net website, and now he's Masjid Toronto's resident imam. So I'm really glad to have such a great panel with us. And just to get started, just so you guys know what the program is going to look like, inshallah, we're close to time. So starting with Dr. Alibhai, and then inshallah, we hope to have our question and answer session just before Isha prayer. And we'll continue questions and answers afterwards if you guys have some after Isha as well. So with that, I'm going to ask Dr. Alibhai to join me at the front.
A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Honored Imam and guests, assalamu alaikum, and thank you so much for this invitation. It's an honor to be here and to be able to present and facilitate a discussion on end-of-life ethics. It's an area of interest of mine because I deal with this every day in clinical practice. And unfortunately, as we get older and as modern technology progresses, life becomes more complex, living in the West. And what we once understood as life and death are not so simple anymore. And so we'll see over the course of the next 35 or 40 minutes why things are more challenging, but Islam, as in all things, provides answers for us and guidance. And inshallah, the Imam will clarify if I make any mistakes, but please do forgive me. What I hope to cover are the following seven areas. First of all, what is end-of-life ethics, so that everyone's clear on what we're talking about? And then second, why is it important? Third, what are some of the principles within the Islamic laws and ethics that apply around our understanding of some of these end-of-life issues? And then specifically getting into some of the issues, for example, DNR, or do not resuscitate, and really saying no to treatment or thinking about the limits of treatment. We'll talk then about the importance of withholding and withdrawing care and why those may not be ethically identical for all madhahib within Islam. We'll talk about some of the differences among the madhahib because not everyone and not every Muslim in every country may necessarily hold identical positions in all areas, and so there are some important differences we need to be aware of. And then I'll end off with a case. In fact, I'll start off with a case just to frame things for you. So if you imagine, and this is a hypothetical case, but it's an amalgamation of multiple cases that I have seen over the years, and I'm sure Ahmed has seen similar cases. A 77-year-old man comes to the hospital who has advanced incurable lung cancer. This cancer has spread throughout his body, and he has failed whatever would be considered conventional state-of-the-art chemotherapy. So there are no further treatments left as far as modern medicine would have, at least not conventional therapies. There may be research studies, but nothing within conventional chemotherapy. He goes to hospital because he's having increasing difficulties breathing. The doctors there give him the best care they can in terms of oxygen, antibiotics for possible infection. They give him some breathing medications to try to open up his airways, but sadly, he is not improving. So then some issues come up around what to do in such a scenario. And so this comes up with the issue of end-of-life ethics. So what are end-of-life ethics? These are issues that relate to when people are dying and they're very ill and in those stages where there may be important decisions that need to be made around further care and the limits of that care. And the ethical issues may be at the individual level, but sometimes they may be at the level of a society. And I'll give an example of that in a moment. Some of the common examples or topics within end-of-life ethics include things like euthanasia, or what some people call a good death, include issues of understanding brain death and whether we as Muslims accept the criterion of brain death, which has not existed until the last few decades. Before that, there was no such thing. It also involves issues like intensive care units, which once again did not exist until about the mid-1930s. And so if you think back, up until the 20th century, most of this was not an issue. You lived, you got medical treatment, and you either survived and got better, or you died. Khalas. Now, things are more complex. It also includes issues of do not resuscitate and the notion of palliative care, which Ahmed will spend some time on a little later. If you imagine, and I'm sorry this doesn't project very well, but if you imagine seeing people in intensive care units, many of you have had the circumstances where you've had loved ones in an ICU and had to deal with the various machines and tubes and devices and trying to come to grips with what we should do, what we can do, and what we must do is not always easy for physicians as well as for patients and families. So these are some of the issues. So I think it's obvious, but I'll state it in terms of answering the question, why is this important? Well, first of all, we recognize we will all die. It goes back to the ayat in the Quran. But more particularly in terms of the Canadian context for Muslims, 71% on average, depending on what study you look at, of Canadians die in a hospital setting. While many of us would wish to die peacefully in our sleep at home, inshallah, most of us will not die at home. And for many, we will not die a simple, peaceful death. There will be challenges along the way. 58% of people who die in any hospital setting die in an acute care hospital that deals with people who are acutely ill. And the average Canadian spends 14 of their last 30 days of life in a hospital. And so many of the challenges occur in hospital settings, which is where I work, and we deal with these all the time. Moreover, people are living longer lives as we have more advances in prevention, in screening, in diagnosis, and in management. People are living longer. But more importantly, they are living longer with more diseases and disabilities, when once upon a time, many of those diseases, if people developed them, they would die. And there would not be a very long period where people would live for decades with many of these illnesses. Whether it's chronic obstructive lung disease or diabetes or heart disease, we have prolonged the survival of people with these illnesses. Alhamdulillah, modern medicine has many advances. But these technologies have not only extended life, but they have found ways to be able to sustain organs that previously we had no way of sustaining inside or outside the body once they got to a certain level of illness. For example, in the 1900s, in the 1800s, 1700s and earlier, if you became critically ill and you could not breathe on your own anymore, you died. If your heart stopped because you had a very dangerous rhythm, you died, etc. There were many circumstances where once you got to a certain level of illness, the organs would fail and death would come. Now, with modern technology, we can temporarily replace the heart. We can transplant new hearts. We can temporarily replace the lungs with machines. We can permanently transplant new lungs. We can transplant kidneys, and so on and so forth. Many of these organ systems, once upon a time when they were sick enough, one would die. Now, many of them we can sustain people for months or years or decades. The question is, what are some of the limits of those therapies? And when do we have the right to say no, if at all, to these potential life-saving therapies? And our very definitions of death have changed. In between the 1930s and 1950s, in North America and other parts of the world, a series of technological advances came about where one could do CPR. I think most of you know cardiopulmonary resuscitation. You press on the chest, you can apply electrical shocks, you can put tubes down people's throats, and you can bring people back, so to speak, from the dead. Or people who are in the throes of dying can often be saved for hours, days, weeks, months, or years. It leads to its own challenges, but once upon a time, we didn't have these structures, but nor did we have a situation where someone's brain may have no function as far as we can measure with modern technology, but the body is still alive. When the brain died before, the body would follow within seconds or minutes. There was no distinction. The definition of death was the body ceased functioning, there was no more pulse, no more breathing. Khalas. Now, if your heart stops and your lungs stop, if you get to people at a certain time point, the brain may have been injured to such a level that there is no measurable brain activity. For all intents and purposes, the brain is dead. But we can keep the heart going. We can keep the lungs going. We can infuse fluids and blood and substitute for the kidneys, and we can keep that body alive, or at least functioning in terms of heart, lungs, etc., for hours, days, weeks. But is that person alive? In the old days, when the body died, from an Islamic perspective, we knew that the soul would depart the body, and we had all of our understandings of the akhirah. Now, if the brain dies, but the body is kept alive, is the soul still there, or has it left? Difficult issues that are not so simple for us, but we must deal with. And in the modern Western world, the other trend is that more and more people want control over every aspect of their lives, including when we die and how we die, rightly or wrongly. But these things bring up challenging issues for us. It hasn't been that long ago, maybe a few months ago, when my most recent patient asked me if I'll help her die. difficult issues for us to deal with when asked such questions. And as I mentioned, sometimes it's not so easy to decide who is alive and who is dead given the modern machines we have. Finally, from an ethical perspective, ignoring Islam and just thinking of secular ethics that society deals with, because ethics applies not just to Muslims, it applies to all of us, and there are ethical issues we all struggle with. There are two major sets of issues that come up when dealing with end of life. The first is the notion of limited resources. This is not at the individual level as much as at the society level. In a given hospital, in a given intensive care unit, there are only so many beds, only so many nurses, only so many ventilators. If there are too many people and not enough ventilators, how do we choose who is the best person to get the limited resources? Because no resource is infinite. And that's an important issue for us to think about as Muslims as well. The second principle that comes up in many ethical discussions, independent of any religion or way of life, the idea of non-maleficence, the idea that we first want to do no harm. Many doctors, patients, and family members fear that at a certain point, we are keeping people alive, but we are prolonging or causing unnecessary or significant suffering. And we may be doing more harm than good. Of course, it's complex because we have different ways of measuring what is harm and what is good, depending on our priorities and our frameworks. But these issues come up when we're dealing in a complicated society, when people have different value systems, different religions, or may have no religious beliefs at all. And so these issues are challenging for all of us, regardless of religion. So let's shift into some issues around Islam and Islamic laws and ethics. I do not need to belabor this point for this audience, as you all know, that the sources of our laws come from four major sources, two primary sources and two secondary sources. The first source, that is our highest source of greatest authenticity because it is the word of Allah, of course, is the Holy Quran. But the Holy Quran does not talk about brain death. It does not talk about ventilators. It does not even talk about blood transfusions, antibiotics, etc. And so we need to go to other sources. The second source that is a primary source is the Sunnah, which of course includes the sayings and actions of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him. And these two sources are used by our scholars to give us guidance when the sources themselves do not give us a direct answer. If you ask a question about a ventilator, it's not in the Sunnah or the Quran. But we must find those solutions. And so if one goes to scholars, they will then use the process of ijma or qiyas in order to come up with a fatwa in order to help us when dealing with issues that were not addressed in the Quran or the Sunnah directly. Moving on to ethics, there are many principles within ethics, but within end-of-life ethics, I'm going to highlight three important ones that I find relevant to us in our discussions and our understanding of how we should behave when dealing with some of these challenges. These are the sanctity of life, which is a principle not unique to Islam. The second key principle is the concept of duties, rights, and our approach to illness. And the third, which is not always talked about in the books, but I think it's important for us as Muslims to understand and communicate with people around us, the notion that suffering can be both good and bad. And one's definition of suffering may not be the same if one is a Christian or a Muslim or a Jew or does not believe in God at all. And so one needs to keep this in context, because oftentimes when you're in an ICU, we'll have these discussions and the nurse or the doctor will say, but the patient is suffering. Well, whose definition of suffering, and is that suffering always bad? We need to keep that in mind because many other groups have difficulty with this notion. Let's go through these in a bit more detail. The sanctity of life is the first and foremost principle that guides so much of the laws that the scholars have given us and so much of the decision making within Islamic ethics. If one goes to Surah Ma'idah, ayah number 32, you will see that there is an ayah that addresses this and is the foundational principle for the sanctity of life. It's not the only one, but it's one of the key ones. It says, in English, the translation is here, "He who slays anyone, man, woman, child, it shall be as though he has slain all of humanity, or mankind as a whole. And he who saves a single life or a human life, it shall be as though he has saved mankind as a whole. So if you're in the job of medicine and saving lives, there's lots of blessings, inshallah. But if you're in the process of being a death doctor, you're in trouble. But the principle of life and the sanctity of life is connected to a second key concept, which is that Allah is the arbiter for Muslims of the beginning of life and the end of life. And Allah decides how long we will live, and our fate is in Allah's hands. We do not have the ability to take that life into our own hands. So if one thinks about the idea of suicide, we know that this is something that is deeply frowned upon and not respected within Islam. It is not something that we consider acceptable. Because in essence, we are giving up on our faith in Allah and that hope in Allah, and we are trying to take life and death into our own hands. Now Allah will not send down His hand and stop us if we try and take our lives, but it is a deep and fundamental disrespect to this body that Allah has trusted us with. Not only that, but the sanctity of life states from almost every scholar within the Islamic tradition and other traditions, by the way, but my focus is on Islam today, that every moment of life is precious. And that's the key. It is not just when we are awake, not just when we are adults, not just when we can speak, not just when we are conscious, at any time when we are alive. Almost all of the scholars have argued, based on the sources, that every moment of that life is precious and worthy and sacred. This then guides so much of the ethical decision making. The second key concept is these connections of duty and responsibility that we have towards one another. It is our duty, first and foremost, to prevent illness, to seek out illness, and the treatment of that illness when we are sick, to preserve life, and to prolong life. If one goes back to the previous verse of the sanctity of life, it is our duty as individuals to look after ourselves and those who have the knowledge to help those who are sick to be able to prolong their lives and to better their lives. There is an interesting hadith from Sahih Bukhari. I don't have the exact verse on me right now, but there's a hadith that goes back to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, that says that Allah has created a cure for every illness. Not that we know all of the cures, but Allah has a cure, a challenge to us who do scientific research to find those cures. Now, in some of the other books of hadith, there's a slightly different version of that hadith. And it says, Allah has created a cure for every illness, except, anybody know?
Death.
Well, you can't cure death. No, except old age. So if you're a geriatrician, you'll probably accept the latter hadith, or you might accept the former, and we think we may even have treatments for old age. I don't know yet, but we'll come to that another day. But the idea is that it is our duty to seek out these treatments for illness, because Allah has given us this body as a trust, and we are to return it to Him in the best shape possible. But also, since life is so precious, our goal is to prolong that life so that we can continue to thank Allah for His blessings and to continue to worship Him in whatever form we can. Even if we're unconscious, we can still worship the Lord. But many secular ethicists don't see that the way we do. The other argument that comes up regularly in the bioethical circles is quality of life. We want to preserve people's quality of life. Islam is not against quality of life. We all want a better quality of life. But many times the argument is made when you're going to stop treatment, that treatment, although it may prolong life a little, it may lead to a lot of decline in quality of life. In general, our scholars have reminded us that the primary decision making for us when thinking about treatment is prolongation of life, not optimizing quality of life. If one needs to trade the two off, and we recognize that sometimes prolonging life is associated with some degree of burden or suffering, the prolonging of life is still, in general, the priority. There are some exceptions, but in general, the first priority is towards prolonging life. And as I mentioned, this principle is not infinite or without limits. There are times when that burden may become so great that we may be able to no longer prolong life but these are rare, exceptional circumstances. I put in brackets the idea, and I'm not going to expand on it now, but we can in the question period, the idea that not only do we have duties for our own bodies, we also have duties to look after one another. Because Islam is not a religion for individuals, it is a religion and a way of life for the ummah, for all of society. We are all brothers and sisters, and we have a responsibility to help one another. So there are additional duties to us in helping those around us who are less fortunate, that we all know, and I don't need to remind you, but those duties extend even to a health context, such as helping those who are sick and visiting those who are suffering. The next key issue is the idea of suffering and why, for Muslims, we don't always view suffering as a terrible thing. And I'm going to qualify that. Suffering is not always bad, but at the same time, our scholars have reminded us that we should not allow unnecessary suffering. In other words, if someone has broken their arm and they're in terrible pain, I shouldn't say to them, this is good for you, it's from Allah, it will wipe away your sins. I should give them pain medication and then say, this is also from Allah. We have the duty to help reduce suffering, but we recognize that some suffering comes from Allah and it has a purpose that is greater than what you and I may understand. Two common examples. Since all of us have sinned in our lives, inshallah, very few, most of you are probably better than I am, but I have sinned. One of the ways in which our sins are neutralized in this life, if we do not do istighfar, is through suffering. It may be through illness, it may be through loss of family, it may be through loss of wealth. There are ayat in Quran that deal with this and remind us that every one of us will be tested and tried. And that some of the suffering will help to wipe away these sins, because either these sins will be accounted for here, or in barzakh, or in the akhirah. But the second key example is that suffering may be a test from Allah even for those who are not sinners and do not have sins to wipe out. A famous example from the story in Quran as well as in the Bible is the story of Prophet Lut and how he was, Prophet Ayub. I put the wrong name down. Prophet Ayub and how he was challenged and went through so much suffering. But that suffering was a trial from Allah. And some of the hadith say that it was because shaitan was trying to test the limits of these prophets of God. And so suffering may have purpose for us beyond just being seen as meaningless, but at the same time, we still have a duty to try to relieve that suffering within the limits that Allah has set. So this gets into the issues of limits and the limits of treatment. So what is DNR or do not resuscitate? As I mentioned a little earlier, when the heart stops or the lungs stop and the person can no longer breathe, one of two things will happen. Either if you do not have access to technology or you do not intervene or you are in a time when you could not intervene, the person would die and would return to Allah, and we all know about that. The alternative is that we can attempt, it will not always be successful, but we can attempt to resuscitate that individual who may be in the throes of dying and once upon a time would have certainly died, but now a certain percentage of those individuals will be saved and that dying process can be temporarily reversed through technologies such as cardiopulmonary resuscitation and electrical shock, etc. And we may be able to resuscitate that individual and keep them alive. People talk about bringing them back from the dead. For Muslims, it's a little problematic because if Allah has decided you're dead, then all the shocks and all the CPR in the world isn't going to bring you back. But if you're in the throes of dying, that's a little bit different. So we have to be careful with our terminology. If you or your loved ones are admitted to a hospital, expect that you will be asked what your wishes are around this end of life aggressiveness of care or level of care or philosophy of care, particularly in those individuals who have a progressive incurable illness or those who are admitted and have a very serious or life-threatening illness or those who are already in hospital but have a major decline and are not getting better but deteriorate in hospital, because these are individuals who are more likely to suffer potentially dying in hospital and the medical team wants to know, if that happens, what should we do? Should we allow option A, the natural death, or should we attempt to intervene and try and resuscitate? And you and your families will be asked, what are your wishes? In Canadian law, I will remind you that in general, a competent adult, one who has the ability to decide for themselves, has the right to refuse treatment, even if that treatment leads to them dying. Doctors cannot force treatment on individuals. At the same time, there have been legal arguments in recent years, and we can get into the details, but for now I'll just summarize. Canadians are not authorized yet to receive treatment with the intent to hasten death, active euthanasia. I cannot take a potassium chloride injection and inject it into a patient yet and cause their death. It is not yet legal, but it will be probably very soon because of a recent Supreme Court ruling. And we'll talk a bit more about that in the question period if you'd like. But then DNR and DNAR are the idea that at some point we can instruct the healthcare team to say, at a certain point in our medical condition, if we get to a certain level, stop further treatment. If my heart stops or my lungs stop, do not attempt resuscitation. Don't give me the shock and the chest compressions and the tubes, etc. Or the similar term is do not attempt resuscitation, because it's really it's all an attempt. It is not guaranteed to be successful. So DNR and DNAR are the same. They're just used in different jurisdictions in the country. But instead of talking about do not resuscitate, many people prefer to have patients and families think about the fact that we are letting nature take its course or leaving the condition in Allah's hands or God's hands. And they will say, if God wants to bring about a miracle or bring about a cure when modern medicine cannot, fine, but otherwise, the anticipated course is that person will pass away because we are not attempting resuscitation. I'm not going to focus on whether this resuscitation is successful or not and what are the chances. That's a whole medical separate topic. My focus is to remind us whether an observant Muslim can accept DNR or must we accept resuscitation in an effort to prolong life at all costs. Because remember, I mentioned earlier, sanctity of life, life is precious, every moment of life. But what are the limits? It is important also to understand, and many people are afraid, that if you accept DNR, the doctors and the nurses will turn that into a do not treat order. And they'll stop any active treatment and focus purely on comfort care. And that is not the interpretation by law, and that is not the ethical interpretation of DNR. All it means is once one gets to a certain point where one is critically ill and needs CPR, intubation, and the technology of the intensive care unit, then either you attempt that resuscitation or not. Prior to that, treatment can continue. The DNR does not cancel those treatments. You can refuse earlier treatments, but that's a different issue. It's not part of typical DNR. And when one accepts DNR or accepts resuscitation, it's not a permanent decision. You can change your mind depending on how the situation is changing or unfolding in a person's healthcare scenario. And so it's not a permanent commitment you've made for the rest of your life. And the last important thing I need to remind you before we get into the details of the ethics is that at the moment, based on a recent Supreme Court ruling called the Rasuli case, that actually happened in Toronto, doctors cannot unilaterally make someone DNR. The Rasuli case involved a family member of a very ill man who wanted everything done and wanted full resuscitation, but the doctor said, this is not appropriate, we do not want to offer this, and we are not going to offer it. And the patient's family challenged it legally and said, you can't do that without my permission. The court case went to three levels of the court. The Supreme Court eventually ruled that doctors cannot make that decision alone. For the moment, it stands that the patient or their family member who is the legal substitute decision maker has the right to accept or decline treatment. Doctors cannot decline it on their own. Okay, and I'm gonna come back to the issue of DNR when we deal back with the case. The other important issue is for some of the madhahib within Islam and in some other religious communities, there is a distinction between withholding and withdrawing treatment. So if you imagine the scenario of someone who is very ill, like that man I gave you in the case, and he cannot get enough oxygen into his body to breathe no matter how much you give him by face mask or by the nasal prongs, whatever. And the only way you can give him that extra oxygen and help his lungs to breathe is with the mechanical ventilator and a tube down his throat. One of the questions that Muslims must ask ourselves is, if you accept that tube, are you then committed to keeping that tube in until that person gets better or dies from another cause on the tube? Or can you remove the tube if, for example, after 5 days or 7 days, it's a hopeless situation and the person is not recovering? Because modern medicine does not always know, when you put someone on a ventilator, whether they will be successfully able to come off that ventilator, whether their body will heal with the antibiotics and the other medications we give them. And so oftentimes, as part of the treatment plan, a trial of treatment is offered. They'll say, let's try this medication, let's try a ventilator for 3 to 5 days and then reassess. And many times, if the person is not getting better, at that point they will recommend withdrawing care. If you withdraw care in someone who needs a ventilator, what will happen? They will stop breathing, they will die. On the one hand, some people have argued that ethically, all you are doing is no longer helping, and the body and nature will take its course. On the other hand, some people in the ethics communities and different religions have argued, now that you are pulling out the tube or unplugging the machine, you are causing death. And if we believe that, and remember Ayah 32 of Surah number 5, then we are committing a grave sin. And so the ethical perspectives on that from Islam are important for us to understand. And I'll answer that in a few moments, but I'm going to leave you in suspense for just a moment. So this was the example of the scenario. Is it the same when you pull the plug, or is it different ethically than starting it in the first place? And I already went through this, so I will move on. Okay, sorry. So the other important thing I'll emphasize, and I'm coming to a closure. It is important to remember that among the different madhahib, and even among in the same school of thought but in different countries, there are sometimes subtle differences in some of the legal rulings, and sometimes major differences. One of the ones that has come up multiple times for myself as well as some of my colleagues, particularly in cities where there's large Muslim populations like Dearborn, where I've been to Islamic conferences and we've discussed this among many doctors, is that particularly the issue of brain death. For example, the majority of scholars within the four Sunni schools of thought, the four major schools, have agreed in international conferences that brain death is now an acceptable criterion for death. If someone is declared brain dead by modern medical science, that person is dead from a Shari'i perspective, and one can proceed with the burial rites, etc. However, there is an important difference, because many of the Ja'fari scholars, the mujtahids within the Ja'fari school of thought, not all, but many, have argued that in fact brain death is not currently acceptable as a criterion for death. And so even among Muslims, Muslim doctors, Muslim patients, it's not just saying I'm a Muslim, one sometimes needs to be more clear. And in situations like this, it is incredibly important to consult with a local imam who knows the person, who knows the family, who knows their particular school of thought and can give guidance. Because these are very challenging issues for people. And when family members have to make these decisions, it's very stressful, and most do not have the expertise. And so we have to be aware of this. Okay, I told you I'm going to come back to the case and try and answer the questions. So, remember the case, 77-year-old man, failing current therapies, can no longer breathe. Three questions. Can an observant Muslim agree to a DNR? If he ends up in the ICU and receives intubation and ventilation, and then 5 days later he's not getting better, and the doctors say that now the prognosis is close to zero and he will likely die, are we allowed to remove the ventilator? And the third question that I will not answer, but it will be a segue to my colleague, is if at that time of critical illness, you get told about the idea of instead of going for the ICU and getting all these treatments, we should focus on palliative care. Because this person is dying, they have advanced lung cancer, there's no cure, we should focus on palliative care and maybe even transfer the patient to a hospice. The question that we must consider, and Ahmed will inshallah answer that, is can we agree to palliative care and are we allowed to go to a hospice? Because I have been asked this by Muslim patients that in scenarios where they want my mother to go to a hospice and that's not allowed in Islam, is it? And so stay tuned for that. First question, are we allowed to agree to a DNR? In general, the scholars have given us the answer that if we are dealing with a reversible illness or an illness that has a reasonable likelihood that if you apply these treatments, the person will have prolongation of life and a chance of either cure or prolonging life, then we must accept those therapies that are going to prolong our life and have a reasonable chance of success. The fatawa that I have seen, and the imam can correct me, the fatawa do not mention a percentage. Because sometimes the doctor will say, oh yeah, what's the percent? 5%, 10%, 20%? We don't have a number. But if there is a reasonable chance that that treatment can prolong life or that the illness in question is potentially reversible, then we must accept treatment including resuscitation. But if we are dealing in a scenario where we are dealing with an incurable illness, at that stage it is permissible to accept a DNR. And that if conventional medical therapies are not able to treat that person, we always pray to Allah and have faith, but we do not need to seek out ventilators, defibrillators, intensive care units in those circumstances. Each one of these cases is generally very complex and challenging. And so while I give you a general rule, as I mentioned, it's always best to consult with a scholar when dealing with the specific scenario, because each scenario is unique, and I've dealt with this many times, and no two scenarios are identical. Second scenario, a second question. If he ended up in the ICU, 5 days of the ventilator, he's not getting better, his lungs are worse, the situation is hopeless, multiple doctors have said there is no chance from current medicine that he will be able to come off the ventilator. Can we remove that ventilator? The majority of scholars, particularly the vast majority of scholars within the Sunni schools of thought, have agreed that we are allowed to withdraw the ventilator at that point if the likelihood of treatment and the likelihood of success of treatment is now felt to be essentially zero. However, a minority of scholars have said that you cannot withdraw because it is not the same as withholding, and the majority of the Shia mujtahids have said you cannot withdraw. Interestingly, the majority of Orthodox Jewish rabbis have also said you cannot withdraw. They have made a distinction between withholding and withdrawing, whereas many Catholic scholars have said you can. So among the different religions, there are many similarities, but some differences in end of life. I will end off with four reminders that I am just at the end of my time, so I had planned it this way. I'm not going to spend time in my discussion on artificial nutrition and hydration, which is, you know, intravenous fluids and feeding tubes and things, but in the discussion period I'm happy to. I will remind us only that living wills are allowed in many Muslim countries, and many scholars have given rulings that it is permissible within Sharia to have a living will where you specify when you are of sound mind that if I become sick, do this, don't do this. You are allowed to specify your wishes within a living will. That is permissible. I will remind you that in general, Islam does not accept autopsies and does not allow them unless it is for criminal investigation or required by law, or if it is likely to lead to knowledge that will save the life of another human being. Outside of that, autopsies are generally forbidden. And again, the imam will clarify and correct me if I'm wrong. And there are limits to treatment and the idea of whether experimental treatment must be accepted, but I don't have time, so I'm not going to get into that right now. And I will end with that and turn it over to Ahmed. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamualaikum. I just wanted to say, if you guys have questions, I'd like you to write them on the back of these forms that Brother Mohsen will hand out to the brother's side. With the pens are here as well, Brother Mohsen. And so we'll only be taking written questions, inshallah. I'll do the same to the sister's side.
It's always a hard task to come after Dr. Alibhai because he's such a good speaker. So, and we can't really reach to his level. So I'm going to try my best here and hopefully I can answer some of the questions. Now, I am a palliative care physician, so this is my area of expertise. It's extremely hard for me to present such a huge topic in 10 minutes. So I'll try my best to answer some of the key questions and try to clarify some of the principles, and I'll be happy to answer some of your questions. Now, as you see from Dr. Alibhai, this is an area of controversy, especially when it comes to taking the decision. I just wanna add a comment to what he said. A lot of times, my experience in dealing with a Muslim patient and taking decision in Islam, there is a lot of emphasis on the medical expertise. So when it comes to DNR decision, a lot of times imams, they will need the medical expert to guide the decision. And usually there is levels of certainty that usually they follow. Anyway, this is something that we can discuss later. But anyway, let's start with the palliative care. So before I start, I just would like to share with you a personal story of mine. I started doing palliative care for the last 3 years. Before that, I was doing family medicine for almost 10 years. I decided to come to the palliative care because I felt the need for that. And I'm going to share with you a personal story of mine. This is actually a person who gave me the permission to share his case. This is a true story of my neighbor. So this is a 74-year-old gentleman. This guy was my neighbor in Saudi Arabia, where I used to practice family medicine. So this guy, he has been diagnosed with liver cancer, and then he was referred to a tertiary hospital because they wanted to offer him a liver transplant. Sometimes when the cancer is confined to one organ, they can do surgery to take this cancer away. So this is why he was referred to this tertiary hospital. Unfortunately, when they did the scans and everything, they realized that the cancer has spread. He has spots in the bone. So the hospital said, there is no point of going for surgery. This is would be non-beneficial treatment for you. You would go for surgery for nothing. But now this, you know how is the emotion. So his family said, no, but we should try. We cannot really just accept the fact that there is no cure. We should try harder. So what they end up doing is they looked everywhere in the world and they find that there is certain treatment available, they find that they can offer this surgery. So the family, it cost like $150,000. They collected the money and they said, this is like our father, money does not care, we want to give him the best treatment. So he went there, he was there for 3 months, he went through the ICU and he went through the surgery. And the surgery was completed successfully. Unfortunately, after he finished his surgery, he went back home. And now the cancer spots in the bone start acting. And he ended up having severe, severe pain. So this guy, he was suffering a lot. He was going to the emergency room and to the hospital in and out because of pain. I still remember his son. He was feeling a lot of pain. He was saying, my father used to scream and cry out of pain. Oh God, please take my life. I don't want to live like this. Please take my life and just save me from this pain. Now, this guy, he died 6 months after the surgery. So this person, he gave me the permission to share his story. This is one of the stories of why I decided to go into palliative care and why I feel that this is very important for all of us. This is one of the reasons why I think that I'm happy today to be here with you and just share with you and tell you more about palliative care and what is the palliative care. So as Dr. Alibhai said, life and death become so complex. In this time, this is like a quote from one of the medical journals. In some respect, this century, scientific and medical advances have made living easier and dying harder. Now, what is palliative care? What do we mean by palliative care? So the word palliate, it means to modify things or to control symptoms. So, but what is palliative care? So I'm going to share with you the international definition. So this is from World Health Organization. This is the definition that is widely accepted for palliative care. It's an approach that improves quality of life for patients and families facing problems with life-threatening illness through prevention and relief of suffering by early identification, impactful assessment, treatment of pain and other problems, physical, psychological, and psychosocial and spiritual symptoms. So, in other words, what we're trying to do here in palliative care, we're trying to focus on the quality of life. We want you to be in the best shape possible. We want you to have the best quality of life possible. We don't want you to suffer. We don't want you to be in pain. We want to make sure that you receive a good treatment that makes you able to do the things that you want to do. So as you can see that all these diseases and terminal illnesses, this comes with considerable pain, with considerable symptoms. This is, could be a cancer, it could be a renal failure, it could be liver failure, it could be heart failure, name it. Most of these illnesses has a lot of symptom burden that can impair your ability to function and impair your ability to do so many things, whether this is enjoying time with family or whether this is like dhikr and ibadah and salah or name it. So our goal here is really to make sure that how can we improve and how can we get you in the best shape possible. Sometimes we do a good job, sometimes we can't, but we're trying. This is what we're trying to do. This is what my patient come to me, I sit with them and I said, how can I help you today? What makes you uncomfortable? How can I make you live a better life? So this is what I normally do in my clinic. Every time patient they come, I sit down with them and I start screening. So I talk about their physical symptoms. I say, do you have any pain? Do you have anything that makes you uncomfortable? How is your appetite? Are you able to sleep well at night? Do you feel tired? Do you feel fatigued? How can I improve all of that? Okay? And then we explore also psychological symptoms. Like, are you depressed? Are you anxious? How can we help you? How can we help you cope with your illness? And then even the spiritual, which is extremely important part. By the way, in... So in terms of spiritual, which is very important part, by the way, for my Muslim patient and for us as a Muslim, spiritual care is also very important part. A lot of times we feel that people are coping by, like religion, give us a lot of hope. And sometimes the spiritual care can also help you in coping with the illness. Now, again, we do a lot of... We kind of do thorough assessment to see how can we help you, even at home. Is there anything that we can offer in order to help you at home? Is there anything that we can do? So we kind of go through comprehensive assessment. Our main goal is really to help you live better. Now, not only that, but also the other goal is, as Dr. Alibhai said, if you're going to die, because this is an illness that we know that is incurable, and there will be a time where things will progress and you will die. So how can we make this death more peaceful, and how can we help you? Now, one of the myths that I have about palliative care, more sometimes people they have in their mind that palliative care is only limited to someone who's dying, like in the last few hours of life. This is like an old, however, the new, as you can see, the new understanding of medicine that we should start early, okay? So palliative care usually started early in any illness. In the beginning, as I told you, our goal is really to help you, so you should not only focus on the last few hours of life. We should start early and work with the other doctors in order to make sure that you're comfortable, you have a good quality of life. Now, what is the evidence? Now, we're doing a lot of research, we're doing a lot of studies. Is this working? This has been introduced now for the last probably 30 to 40 years. Is it really working? Well, surprise, the evidence that we see that it's really working well. So people who received early palliative care, they had good quality of life, but not only that, the surprise thing that they lived longer. This is like a study that they did for lung cancer patients, and they realized that when they offered early palliative care, at the end of the day, compared to the standard care, the early palliative care group, they lived longer. Now, we are, as a physician, we are puzzled by that. How come, like, what is the magic about palliative care? Why is it, like, help some people to live longer? It should not, like, we're not dealing with the life prolongation. We're dealing only with the quality of life. So we have many theories. One of the theories that we have, sometimes in medicine, doing more is less. So to going through a lot of interventions, although it seems like quite fascinating, a lot of times these interventions have significant side effects and significant mortality. So part of why we think that people survive longer is because they receive less chemotherapy. And then when you receive less chemotherapy, they were able to survive for a longer time. This is one theory. The other theory that we have is because people have a good life, they are less anxious, they have less depression, and they have less distress, so they live longer. Now, we don't know if this is applicable to all the illnesses, but definitely it's something interesting. The goal of the people who started the trial is not really to look for that, but this is an interesting thing that we have. Now, for quality of life also, people felt quite comfortable and they had a good life. So you can see that it's win-win situation. Now, let's talk about the Muslim, from Islamic perspective. Is there any reason, does palliative care contradict with Islam or with Islamic value? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah, Ayah 185, verse 185, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Quran is saying that He wants you to choose the easier path, not the hard path. Now, Rasul, there is also hadith for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam alayhi ma khuyira bayna amrayn illa ikhtara aysarahuma. So whenever Prophet Muhammad had to choose between two things, he would choose the easier one. So you can see that this is probably easy. Now, the other thing that usually with palliative care, because we want to improve the quality of life, sometimes we try to minimize some unneeded intervention. Medicine becomes like so focused on intervention. Let's do things. Let's do walking. Let's do more blood work. Let's do more things. So palliative care, they try to minimize that. We're trying to bring sense. So what is the most important thing here? How can we make things easier for you? How can we make things, like, we're trying to bring the perspective of the person, of the patient. Is this like important thing? What's the most important thing? Now, as Dr. Alibhai do, sometimes this is like the way of medicine being practiced in Canada, or from secular perspective when they ask you about what you want, But you can see that there is no contradiction with the Islamic value. Now, one of the other things that I also get, because there is a lot of talk about the assisted suicide and about euthanasia. So is palliative care is about that? Is it about going ahead and ending life prematurely or hastening death? The question for that is palliative care is not about hastening death. So what we tell our patient that we will not interfere. We will not try to hasten death. And this is not something that we're aiming for. This is actually a statement from the Canadian Society of Palliative Care Physicians. So this statement coming in the response of the Supreme Court approving or legalizing assisted suicide. So in their statement, this was done in February and it's available online. It says that the majority of our members are opposed to legalizing euthanasia or assisted suicide. And the majority of our members believe that euthanasia and physician-assisted suicide, if legalized, should not be provided by palliative care services or by palliative care physicians. So we're trying, so palliative care is quite distinct from hastening death. It's mainly about making sense of what are we offering and what kind of intervention are we accepting. I will end here and I'm happy to take any questions that you have. I just want to give you a quick conclusion. So palliative care is about good life and quality of life. It should be provided in the early stages of life. It does not contradict with Islamic values or laws. Palliative care is different and distinct from assisted suicide and from euthanasia. Part of what we are interested in is how can we improve palliative care for Muslim patients? How can we develop an approach that would fit with Islamic values? And this is perhaps what Dr. Alibhai and myself are doing. We're trying to speak to doctors in international conferences and conferences about what is the Muslim way of looking at death and how can we improve the care provided for Muslims. Thank you so much. And
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Brother and sister, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. First of all, I do welcome Dr. Shabbir and Dr. Ahmed and sister Arteen, and I welcome you all to Masjid Toronto. MashaAllah, I'm so pleased that Masjid Toronto is making difference in our community. So many masjids don't make what Masjid Toronto does. So I'm so happy that, alhamdulillah, we host medical events, we host social events, we host of course, religious and spiritual events. So I do invite my brother and my sister in the Muslim Medical Association of Canada to come more and more frequently to Masjid Toronto. On behalf of myself and on behalf of the Masjid Committee, I welcome them anytime to the Masjid. Jazakumullahu khairan. For my talk, I will try and brief, cover and speak about some Islamic values that govern the issue of end of life care from a Muslim perspective. And to cover that issue, that important and serious issue, I will try to speak about some introductions, some basic values from an Islamic perspective before reaching my conclusion, before speaking about my conclusion on the issue. First of all, in Islam, in our Sharia legacy, we have five higher objectives of Sharia. And one of these five objectives of Sharia is to protect the human life. So the protection of the human life is one of the main five objectives of Sharia that all our scholars agree on. Our scholars agree on that in Islam or our Islamic values and ruling came to protect by values. Among these by values is to protect the human life. And before that is to protect one's faith, and then one's life, and one's mind, and one's honor, and one's money. And our scholars even discussed whether the protection of one's life takes precedence over the protection of one's faith. Some of them say that protection of the religion and one's faith takes priority and takes the precedence. While others say that no, it's the protection of the human lives that takes precedence. And they found their opinion in the famous story of Ammar ibn Yasir. You know Ammar ibn Yasir, when the people of Quraysh detained him and persecuted him, and he was forced to utter some words of disbelief. And when he returned back to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told him that if they return back, you also can return back. And the Quran says, "Illa man ukriha wa qalbuhu mutma'inun bil iman," except those who are forced to say some words of disbelief while their hearts are filled with iman. That's why our scholars say that to protect and to preserve the human life is one of the main five objectives of our religion. The second value that I like to cover is the sacredness of the human life. Human life is sacred. And now we are in a sacred month, Dhul Qa'dah. And here we remember the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam last Hajj, in which he addressed the people and asked them, "O people, in what day you are in?" They were in the day of Eid al-Adha. And they said, "We are in a sacred day." And he asked them more, "And in what month you are in?" And they replied, "We are in a sacred month." And he asked them further, "And in what city you are in?" And they said that, "We are in a sacred city." And he said that, "Ala inna amwalakum ودماءكم وأعراضكم عليكم حرام كحرمة يومكم هذا في بلدكم هذا في شهركم هذا." The Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم made it clear to them that your blood, meaning your life, your money, your honor is forbidden to you as you are in a forbidden or in a sacred city, in a sacred month, in a sacred day. And when the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم finished his talk, he said, "Allahumma ballaqt, Allahumma fashhad." "Oh Allah, I have delivered the message. Bear witness that I have delivered the message." And Ibn Abbad, the one who reported that hadith, commented that this is the message of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So those who are present should deliver the message to those who are absent. That is the second point. The third point I like to cover is the issue of medication. When it comes to the issue of medication, our scholars say that it's recommended to the person to seek medication. The Prophet Muhammad said that, "Tadawu ibadallah," as Dr. Shabbir said, "Tadawu ibadallah," all people seek medication. So it's in our religion, in our Islamic faith, it's recommended to seek medication. However, it's permissible to give up medication for some reason. Permissible to give up medication for some reasons or some excuses, just to give up medication. And you will explain, inshallah, in the conclusion. Now the issue of the definition of this. In fact, I see the problem that we usually depend and build on the old opinions. Dr. Shabbir, mashallah, made a survey of the scholars of Islam, the Sunni schools and the Shia schools and so on. But these opinions are correct in their times. What we are in need now is to have a new ijtihad. Now we have new visions, we have advanced technology. Our scholars did their best, did their utmost to reach to the ijtihad that suits their time and their circumstances. That's why we see some of them define this ad this of the heart or of the brain, and in their time that was perfect. It was a perfect ijtihad, meaning it was a perfect fatwa at their time. But what we are in need now is to study the issue again with what we have of the advanced knowledge, of the advanced method, research, medical research, to reach conclusions that suit
our time and our circumstances. We shouldn't build on the old opinions, though these opinions can be the foundations, but we should have new ijtihad that suits our time and our circumstances. Otherwise, we will not do our duty in a perfect way. I myself inclined to adapt the view that says that this is when the soul parted the body. When the soul parted the body. And I see some hints in the Quran that maintain that fact. When you read the Quran, you will find that some ayat that speak about this with is when the soul parted the body. For example, Allah Almighty said in the Quran, Allah يتوفى الأنفس حين موتها والتي لم تمت في منامها فيمسك التي قضى عليها الموت ويرسل الأخرى إلى أجل مسمى. Allah Almighty said that Allah Almighty caused this to the people while they are sleeping, and then He withhold the souls of those whose death is due. While those who still have life, Allah Almighty sends back their souls. And even in some of the ahadith and the dua of Shabbir, since that we don't have some ahadith that speak about this, we have some ahadith, but we need really to study these ahadith from a scientific visions, from a new scientific visions, and from a new scientific perspective, from new medical perspective. The Prophet Muhammad in one of the hadith says that إن العبد المؤمن إذا كان في إدبار من الدنيا وإدبار على الآخرة. The Prophet Muhammad explains the situation of this when he said that when the believer is about to die and he is about to depart this world and to go to the afterlife, to angels to come to him, and they ask the soul to depart the body, addressing the soul that أَيَّتَهُ الرَّوْحُ أَيَّتَهَا الرَّوْحُ الطَّيِّبُ أُخْرِجِ إِلَى رَأْحِ, meaning that they address the soul, go out, oh good soul. So I myself inclined at that moment to define this as it's the state when the soul parted the body. But what's before that are manifestations of the this. It's not the actual this, it's the manifestation. And it's for me, it was surprise to find some of our early scholars to say that we have to leave the dead person for a time until his smell change, until his smell changes and some manifestations of his body will change. So for the time it was perfect. We need to have a new ijtihad that suits our time. For the issue of euthanasia, in fact, our scholars have studied this issue and tried their best, and we need to build on their conclusions and on their fatwas. They spoke about the issue of euthanasia, and they said that we have many types of euthanasia. We have direct or deliberate euthanasia, when the patient himself or his doctor, with the patient's permission or with the family's permission, ends the life of the patient. And this form of euthanasia is haram, it's not allowed in Islam, because you end the life of a patient on purpose, whether it's with the permission of the patient himself or with the permission of the patient's family. It's haram, it's not allowed, because the life is a trust. Our lives are trust, it's amana. So we can't end our life in that way. And the second type of euthanasia, as our scholars say, is the assisted suicide, as Dr. Ahmed spoke about it. And it's also haram, it's not allowed, because it means that the patient seeks some help. Maybe someone will give him some medication, some drugs, some any helpful tools to end his life. And it's suicide, and it's called assisted suicide. It's not allowed in our Islam, in our Sharia, it's not allowed. You may know the hadith and the story of the man who died in one of the battles of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the people said, oh, mashallah, may Allah bless him, he will be in the highest place in paradise. But the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them that no, he will be in the hellfire, because he has a sphere he had severe pains of his wound, and he bought his sword in his wound to end his life. So he will go to the hellfire. He ended his life by his hand, and he didn't bear the pains for a while. So he will go to the hellfire. Though the people imagine that he was shaheed, he was a martyr. And the third type of euthanasia, as our scholars say, and I'm not specialized in the medical issues, but that's what our scholars say. So I may commit some mistakes in the type, and of course our dear doctors can correct me. The third type is indirect euthanasia. Indirect euthanasia, I think Dr. Shabbir hinted to it, is when the doctor gives the patient some drugs to relieve his severe pains. But the doctor knows that with the long term, this medicine will affect his life, will end his life. So it's not also permissible. It's not allowed for the doctor to do that, because he will assist in ending the life of a human person. It's a sacred life that we can't in any way assist on purpose in ending that life. And the final type is the passive euthanasia. The passive euthanasia is to give up and to stop medication. And in fact, our scholars have studied this issue recently, and some of our Muslim councils which studied this issue said that in very, very rare situations, in very critical situations, such as the case of brain death, the patient's family can decide to stop what they call life support, and to leave the patient to his faith and to his color, and don't bear the huge costs of continuing on the life support, though that person is clinically dead. And after that, after this conclusion, after these introductions, I like to say something. It's in fact not a yes or no reply. It's so difficult to say yes or no general reply. But every case should be studied differently. Each situation should be studied differently. And also, Dr. Shabbir pointed to one fact: we are not sure about the percentage. When the doctor can go on and stop medication or continue medication, what's the percentage? Is it 5% or? And here I recall what in our Sharia legacy say, we usually build on ghalabat al-dhan. When it's the most imagined or mostly expected, something will happen. That's ghalabat al-dhan. We in our Sharia build on ghalabat al-dhan. But what's less than said, 5%, it's insignificant in our Sharia. My conclusion is that this issue needs more ijtihad, needs new ijtihad. And I'm so happy that we are here to speak about this problem that needs more and more research, more comprehensive research. And I really call on the Muslim community to reread the Quran from different perspective. Our problem is that we try to understand the Quran only through the old perspective. Though now we are in need to read the Quran and to understand the Quran through scientific, medical visions and linguistic visions. We need all together and to study the Quran. I have the belief that, and you all have the belief that, Allah Almighty says, مَا فَرَّطْنَا فِي الْكِتَابِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. We didn't leave anything but in the Quran, but it's our own duty to reflect and to study the Quran from different perspectives. My conclusion is that this issue, the end of the life care, can't have a single blah, yes or no. And each case should be judged according to the situations. And our scholars in our fiqh legacy says that الحكم على الشيء فرعا عن تصوره. To pass a judgment over something, you should have a clear concept of it. So the doctor should have a full concept of the case. He is treating, and the scholar and the family should have clear concept of the situation. Then at the time they can say whether to go in that way or in the other way. And again and again, we need to have new ijtihad and new fatwas that suit our circumstances and our conditions, and that will build on the advanced technology and on the research that we have. Jazakum Allahu khairan. We conclude here for the Salat approaching. I don't know whether we can have some questions before the Salat or we should wait after the Salat. Assalamu alaikum.
Or I think somebody's trying to give the azan upstairs. We'll have the question answer session inshallah after the salah because it's only 5 to 6 minutes left. You can go make wudu inshallah. Just a few announcements before we leave. Tomorrow, Dr. Wael will be giving a lecture inshallah on the Dhul-Hijjah days that are approaching us. You're all welcome to join as well tomorrow after Dhuhr here at the masjid. We'll have a lecture. 1.5 hour inshallah, followed by lunch in the community. You can have lunch with us, so you're all welcome once again. The second announcement is that the Muslim Association of Canada launched a campaign yesterday, Embracing Syria. In this campaign, we're trying to sponsor families from Syria to come to Canada, and Masjid Trump is playing a very important part in this. You're all welcome to donate to this as well. You can donate in the office, inshallah, upstairs if you would like to participate in this. Jazakumullah khair.
Inshallah, we've gotten a lot of questions, so I'd like to use the time when you guys are here to get through the majority of them while we have Dr. Alibhai and Dr. Al-Awamer with us as well. And I'll talk softer. Okay, so inshallah, the first question is, Islamically, is there any rulings regarding substitute decision maker? If I recall correctly, legal rulings in Canada state that spouse is prioritized over parent, I think. Is there any ruling regarding this Islamically? So I'll open up the questions for whoever would like to take them.
It's a good question, and in different countries, different Muslim countries, there have been some differences, because within Islamic tradition, as I understand it, and the Imam can correct me if I'm wrong, but for a woman, a married woman, her husband is the first decision maker. But for a man, his wife is not the first substitute decision maker if he is incapable in many of these Islamic countries. They have a different, slightly different hierarchy of decision makers. Now, I am not clear, I have to go back to my sources, I'm not clear if that was based on a juridical fatwa or that was just the country's legal interpretation, but even when one goes back to divisions of assets and decision making in non-medical areas after someone dies, there is a hierarchy of decision makers, and that hierarchy is slightly different from the Sharia perspective than from Canadian law. But perhaps the Imam can give us further guidance on that.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. In fact, when the scholars speak about the person's family, we have ranks of the or degrees in the family members. So, as Dr. Shabbir said, for the wife, the husband is the one who is most close. And we can understand that from the division of the inheritance. The husband takes half of the inheritance in some cases. And we have the son. So I think it might be different from one case to another when a person has a son and has a wife. And so we can go to the most close, to the closer one who will take a big part of the inheritance. And we can consult most of the family members, not depend on any given person. And now in our last will document, by the way, we are working on a last will document here in the masjid. Inshallah, it will be issued very soon, because we see there is a need, there is a dire need for a last will document to be, inshallah, in the hand of every one of us. The one should decide in his last will who should, inshallah, have say in such critical situations. Jazakumullah.
So the second question is, as a Muslim physician, if a patient substitute decision maker requests DNR or slash DNAR with holding of treatment, even though as a physician you believe that treatment could help, how would you deal with such a situation as a Muslim physician?
It's another great question. So there are a few principles that I keep in mind as a practicing physician, and I struggle because sometimes Canadian law will ask us to do things that may not be consistent with our belief system, and we all have to struggle with that and find where we're going to draw our boundaries and what we will do. But I do a few things. First of all, I will find out how observant these individuals are, because just because the religion describes for us what we ought to do, the religion does not compel individuals to do things. See, people have choice. There are Muslims who do not follow and are not observant. So the first thing I try to understand is, are they aware of the Islamic position, and are they choosing to make a different decision? Or are they not aware and are they ignorant? If they're ignorant of what the Islamic position is and they want to know it and are willing to follow it, if that's the correct position, then I will try and inform them and encourage them to speak to their imam, because I often meet these patients and only know them for hours or days. It's much harder to achieve a trusting relationship unless you really have known someone for a long time. And this is why the local imam in the community is someone who may have known this family for many years and will be a person they trust. The second thing I do is, if they are not interested in following what I think is the best course and they are informed, then that is their choice. As long as they do not force me to do something that is against Sharia from my perspective as a practicing physician, then it's their choice. If they, for example, refuse antibiotics or refuse life-sustaining therapy, then that is their choice, and it is my duty to make sure they are informed, and then they make their decision.
I just want to add one thing with regard to Muslim physicians. So as a Muslim physician, so we follow certain rules, and we follow the laws here. So one of the laws here that we cannot really force any type of treatment on any person. So as a physician, if someone is refusing any treatment or refusing life sustaining and say, no, I don't want it, it's legally by law, I can be charged with battery for really forcing any treatment. So there is a high regard for the person choice and for autonomy. So this is one of the law of the land.
So the next question is about specifically about the living will. So what can be specified in the living will according to Islam? Is it okay to specify do not resuscitate? Is it okay to specify remove the tube if there's no possibility of patient being able to breathe on their own? Would this mean we are taking a life?
So it goes back to the ethical issues around what does Islam advise in certain levels of care. The living will is simply a document that allows you to state your wishes in a situation, in the various situations that are described, where individuals typically are no longer able to communicate their wishes, but they want their previously expressed wishes to be followed. Those wishes, if they are consistent with Sharia, there is no problem. You can pre-specify those wishes. It is analogous to a wasiya or a will, where you are specifying how things are to be distributed. Two-thirds of the property you have no choice over, and one-third you have some choice in what you wish to do. In a living will, if you specify things that are consistent with Sharia, then there is no problem and you are allowed to do so. The challenge with living wills, whether Muslim or non-Muslim, are writing them, is can you give enough detail to deal with all the circumstances and variations and permutations that apply? And so this is why, personally, for example, I do not have a living will. I have a power of attorney document for someone to make my decisions for me. Now it's a burden on that person. I feel badly for them because life is complicated when you're that sick. But I have not gone with a living will, because if you really want to follow Sharia, then the living will would have to be very detailed and specific on what circumstances you would allow treatment, what circumstances you would say DNR, etc.
And in circumstances where if you are comfortable with giving that level of detail, and I know Muslims who have done this, it is not objectionable within Sharia. Sharia allows it. And for example, if you are one of the, belong to a school of thought where withdrawing of a ventilator under certain circumstances is permissible, when the person, for example, is brain dead, or the person has, as the Imam said, essentially no chance of success, and that in all likelihood treatment is now futile and the person will pass away, then you are allowed to specify that in the living will, because it is simply an extension of the Sharia. Where we have a problem is if you specify something in the living will that is not consistent with Sharia, but then that's between you and Allah, because you've written it down, and if the physicians follow it, it's your responsibility. So you have to be very careful when specifying things in a living will document, because when things get complicated, there's no one to interpret it other than what's written down.
I guess I just want to second Dr. Alibhai with regard to the living will. This is a document that it aims to help the substitute decision maker to make the decision on his behalf. It's not to be interpreted by the physician, or it's not to be taken as it is. The person who's making the decision on his behalf, this is something just to guide him, to help him when making the decision to understand what's your wishes. This is in the Canadian law understanding that the advanced directive in the living will is mainly to guide the person who makes the decision in making his decision and what kind of treatment would you or would you you don't like to have. Now, I just want to, one of the things I find people sometimes struggle with, the DNR, for example, or to accept or refuse life-sustaining life support. And in my, one of the ways to look at that is to look at it from the perspective of medical decision. Some of these interventions are purely medical intervention. So some of the countries, for example, they depend mainly on the medical expert decision. For example, when I was working in Saudi Arabia, DNR, for example, is a decision to be made by the physician. So if three physicians agree that this person will not benefit from life support, then they will make this decision and they will sign that this person is a DNR. Now, this may not really work with the Canadian law because the physician cannot really make the decision here. But if you look at it from Sharia, usually the Sharia will take in consideration what the physician has to say because they are the expert, and based on their level of ghalabat al-dhan or the certainty level, if they have ghalabat al-dhan and they think that this treatment is probably not going to be beneficial and it will not prolong life, and if there is like a consensus, well, consensus is probably hard, but would say the majority of physicians have this agreement, then this will make a strong case from Islamic law, I think, and probably Sheikh Imam can.
Dr. Ahmed, yes, I support what you said and also what Dr. Shabbir said, but just I wanted to make it clear that it's advisable and it's recommended for everyone to have his will and to have what we call last will and testament. Because you know that we need to make sure that everything will go according to the Sharia values, and every one of us should be careful in this regard, because we don't know, subhanAllah, it's unseen issue when the person will be in a situation when things should be decided without him being in. So it's very important for everyone to have his last will, to have his living will, according to the Sharia. We are working in something in the masjid right now. Inshallah, hopefully within a few weeks it will be, inshallah, issued with details, with Islamic backing and support, what's supposed for everyone, inshallah, to make in his last will, inshallah. Jazakumullah.
So the a question that's come up many times in these papers is, what are the rulings regarding organ donations? I know Dr. Alibhai this was not one of the topics that we were going to discuss, but are you comfortable talking about it, or will it take more time than we have? Another session. So inshallah, maybe we'll have another session on organ donation. Inshallah. Else that has come up that I actually think would be quite relevant is medical marijuana in terms of, like, in the context of palliative care acceptable for pain relief? So I'll maybe let him take that.
I think we had some discussion about this question, and I think there is certain rules has to be applied when we're looking and evaluating medical treatment. So there is like certain steps and way to evaluating any medical treatment and whether this is permissible or not. Normally we would have to look into this from, first of all, from medical perspective. So any treatment that we want to apply, is this like a medical that is known to be beneficial? Is there some level of certainty to say that this is a beneficial treatment and the person will benefit from that? So I guess this is like a question that needs more information and more investigation, and then it depends on the context, because the problem with medical marijuana is that it does not, it has some evidence, but the evidence is not that strong, like from medical practice. So usually it's not our first line treatment that we offer to our patient for pain management. There are other medication which is known to be beneficial. This marijuana would come into like the fourth or fifth line agent in terms of pain management. So it depends on the context. I won't say like this is an... First of all, I'm not a scholar, so I can't tell you with certainty what's the religion ruling. But any treatment that we look into, we have to look into the medical perspective, and if this is, and to the person condition, what's the situation here, what's the necessity, what's the need, and is this medication going to be beneficial? And then after that, we look into, is this treatment will contradict with other Islamic ruling? For example, are we using any forbidding material like alcohol or pork, and is it like contradict with the Islamic Sharia, maqasid al-Sharia, preservation of life, wealth, honor. So there is a lot of steps in order to evaluate a treatment. And I don't think that we have the full picture here to say absolutely yes or absolutely no.
So, Shah, the next question is, someone mentioned experimental treatments and acceptability. Can you please repeat that and give some examples?
So the issue that's come up a few times in my practice, and I'm sure it's come up in others, is an example. For example, I had a middle-aged woman with advanced breast cancer who had gone through multiple lines of chemotherapy, and for a time, each one of them helped, and then they stopped helping, and her disease progressed to the point where every major line of chemotherapy had been tried and had failed. The doctors came to her and her husband and said, we have experimental therapy that might be beneficial. We don't know. It's still under investigation in clinical trials, so it's not yet proven, not yet approved in Canada. And this woman and her husband asked me, are we obligated to undergo this treatment? They weren't that interested in it because she was, frankly, quite unwell and exhausted, but she also was an observant Muslim. And when this is not my area of expertise, so when I spoke to scholars, my understanding, and the Imam can correct me if I'm wrong, is that experimental therapies, because they are not proven, and it is unknown if they are going to prolong life or not, we are not obligated to accept them. People have a choice, as long as the risk is low. Because if there is a high risk of harm and a small risk of success, then it's definitely not allowed. If we know they are going to prolong life, then we should take them. But if we do not know either, then one is not obligated to undergo this experimental therapy.
Yes, he would, what Dr. Shabbir just right now said, because we in Sharia we don't build on doubts, but we build on what's most probably غلبت الظن, and also harm should be avoided. It's another ruling in Sharia, and الضرر يزال, harm should be removed and should be avoided as much as we can.
The next question is, can you share resources for people, friends, family who need to make decisions for their loved ones during end-of-life care? Any well-known scholars, books, or resources you can refer us to? And to that question, I wanted to add, we've talked a lot about having an imam to go to when those decisions come up. So just some information about how you could coordinate something between your physician and the imam as well.
I think that's a fantastic question and a difficult one, because I have found in my own practice that not all the imams are comfortable discussing these issues, and not all people are comfortable going to their imam. Some feel very embarrassed or shy, but I think the imam of that local community would be a tremendous resource. I don't know a good mechanism to connect doctors and imams in any consistent way, because one of the things, if one thinks about, many hospitals have ethics committees or they have chaplains that provide spiritual care. There are virtually no ethics committees in Canada that have Muslim representation on a regular basis. There are very few trained chaplains who are Muslims. There are chaplains who understand a little bit about Islam, but a Muslim chaplain is very different than a chaplain who knows a little bit about Islam, and most chaplains don't know very much about Islam at all. And so at a practical level, it's difficult, and these are areas where members of the Muslim community are encouraged to become experts and become local chaplains and things, because it is a need for the broader society. In terms of resources, there are some resources that are written for physicians and scholars, that various ones. There are books and there are articles on, there are now at least 24 or more articles in English on Islamic ethics, but they're not geared to patients and families. I am not aware of any good resource right now for patients and families. I know that I think it's the Canadian Association of Muslim, I'm blanking on the name of the association. There was a move a few years ago to create a booklet summarizing some of the Islamic ethics positions. I don't know if that ever got completed, because I wasn't able to join the panel, and I don't know if a resource was made available for patients and families or the lay public. I don't know if other people in the audience or Ahmed or the Imam know of other resources. I don't know of any that are primarily geared towards lay individuals, lay Muslims.
Yeah, I think that this is a gap that we have, unfortunately. So we have some end-of-life resources, but it's not meant to be, it's like available for everybody. So if you want something that is specialized, for example, for Muslim persons, we don't have a lot of resources, unfortunately, available. There is a lot of resources about end-of-life in general, and for patient, and what to expect, and what kind of treatment is you can get, and all of that. But sometimes for specific issues, like that is related to decisions, I can't remember anything. Now, I also second Dr. Alibhai with regard to chaplain. Like just last week, I have one patient who was asking for imam, and unfortunately, this person was not very well connected with the community. But you know, sometimes around the end of life, like spiritual issues will start coming, and person is really looking to deal with some of the bending issues. So he asked to speak to imam, and it was really very hard for us to find someone for him. Like the chaplain is not it's non-denominational, so it deals with all different religions. But he wanted specific advice with regard to Islamic practice, and unfortunately it was long, we couldn't really find anyone, and eventually he ended up dying without seeing the imam. So you can see that this is a big gap sometimes in our area, and I'm hoping that with time we'll be able to come up with resources.
Sorry, two other points, and then the imam wished to add. There are some articles also written for nurses. So most are written for physicians or general sort of medical audiences. Some are written for nurses. But then the other point is, some hospitals do have connections with imams that are available on call, either at certain hours or a 24-hour call, but it's not in every hospital by any means. And in fact, from my experience, it's only a minority of hospitals where the chaplains have access to imams that are available. But perhaps the imam can shed some light on his experience.
In fact, my experience is very limited because I'm new to Canada, just 5 months here. But as you know, our masjid, alhamdulillah, is so close to at least 7 public hospitals. And we never use anyone who sends us or a relative comes to us to ask for help or for a visit. Me and Shabbir Hamid did that. And in our website, we have asked the imam and usually reply the questions on time. Sometimes even after the fajr in the middle of the night, sometimes my wife saying, what do we do now? It's the middle. Usually, when I receive a message and I got notification in my mobile, I usually check the message. When it's urgent, I reply on time. So we try our best to meet the needs of our community as much as we can.
Yeah,
Jazakallah,
that's an offer that we're all going to take you up on now, inshallah. So this question is about palliative care, and it says palliative care is not hastening death. Correct me if I'm wrong when I'm reading this question, I couldn't make out one word. So palliative care is not hastening death, but if feeding becomes contraindicated, so there's a risk of choking, can you withdraw food? Is that the question that someone wrote? I believe that's my understanding of what the question is. So basically withdrawing food, I think that's what it's alluding to.
So again, the question about feeding. Usually these questions should be individualized, looking into the person, into the person's situation. Because depending on the person's situation and depending on his expected survival, so, for example, someone who have life expectancy of hours, 2 days, someone who is expected not to survive for too long. At this time, the value of feeding in terms of like prolonging life or in terms of also improving quality of life would become questionable, like someone who is actively dying. Now, when it's longer than that, when someone is expected to survive longer than hours to days, then the question with regard to the feeding, what's the situation, why he can't eat, and what's the alternative available for him? So sometimes there is other alternative, like for example, artificial nutrition through tubes. This may be or may not be an option as well. So it doesn't work for everybody. So again, it might seem, this is like, from medical perspective, it's not an easy question. We have to look into the details and look into the options and look into the also the person's situation. And based on that, we can decide what's our option here. Is artificial nutrition, is this an option or not? If he's unable to eat, if this is an option, would he benefit from that with this type of nutrition? Will prolong his life or not? For example, certain types of dementia, advanced dementia, this is Dr. Alibhai area, I'm not the expert there. The research say that it may not really prolong life. So I'm afraid that the answer to this question is not straightforward. It's a very loaded question and it depends on the context of the situation.
Yeah, I mean, we could spend an hour just on this. I'll only add one point, and that is, when we're dealing with competing priorities, virtually nothing trumps the sanctity of life. And so if other obligations have to be violated, for example, hijab, drinking alcohol, eating pork, in order to survive, they must be done. Because sanctity of life trumps almost everything else. So if life is put at risk by feeding, then one stops feeding, because the priority is that sanctity of life. And that's a general principle. Beyond that, all of the complications and challenges as Ahmed described, it becomes a very complex scenario, and there are guidelines and methods of deciding, but there's a lot of information one needs to gather in order to make those decisions.
So we're just gonna go until inshallah 10:30, so two more questions inshallah. Is that okay, Dr.? So one of the questions was, for Muslims working in healthcare, how do you think the recent decision by the Supreme Court regarding physician-assisted suicide will impact our practice, especially if we are asked to be involved in these decisions? Are there forums to talk about this?
So we're still debating. So we know that this will become legal, like assisted suicide, it will become legal in February. But the ruling of the Supreme Court says that physician, also they are not to be forced to practice this. So you still have the choice as a physician. So the ruling itself says that patient has the choice, the person has the choice to choose whether to go for assisted death or not. And then the physician himself, he has also his autonomy, so he has the choice to participate in this or not. This wasn't the same rule. Now, the mechanism how this would be delivered is still highly debatable because we don't have guidelines. The government has just started like a consulting committee that would look into the situation, and also the provincial colleges, like for example, the College of Physician and Surgeon are looking into that. So the mechanism of that is still not clear. It will probably become legal in February, but the mechanism is not clear. And the good thing is that the physician still has the freedom to choose.
The only other point I'll add to that, I completely agree with Ahmed. There are a number of fora in which these discussions are going on for people who wish to contribute and share their concerns. Full credit should be given to the Canadian Palliative Care, I can't remember the official name of your group, the Canadian Palliative Care Physicians, because they have had multiple discussions, and there are many religious groups that have participated in discussions objecting to the Supreme Court ruling and have been led predominantly by Catholics. And the Catholic diocese and Catholic healthcare groups and others, many Christian groups particularly, have encouraged and are still having ongoing discussions, and they are not denominational. They have invited, I've been invited, they've invited any groups and individuals who feel that they need to have their voice heard and want to register their concern and make sure that physicians aren't forced to do things that are against our principles. So I encourage you all, those in healthcare who want to lend a voice, to participate in these groups. There are many of them around, and their voices continue to be heard.
So one of these questions, I'm not sure if you will take specific situational questions, but it says, my father had cancer. We never told him he had cancer, and we gave him false hopes that he would recover soon. Was it right on our part or not to disclose that he had cancer and give him false hope?
So this is a common scenario that we encounter a lot, where family wants to protect their loved one. They don't tell him that he has cancer, and then we don't talk about it. So the family do not talk about it with the patient. And the patient himself, my experience with that he feels the pain, he feels the illness. He goes to cancer center, he receives chemotherapy, but then he doesn't know that he has cancer. So I find that this sometimes is, it creates a lot of barrier for the person himself. So he doesn't have the chance to express his opinion or to express his feelings. Now, when someone is sick, he knows that he's sick. And he knows that this is a serious sickness. Everybody knows his body. So by not talking about that, sometimes it might create this environment that we're not talking about it. He can't really he cannot talk about his fear. He cannot really share his opinion about the treatment and the complication and the side effects. So it may interfere with his treatment. A lot of times the health, the law here says that the person has to be in charge and has to give the consent. So you will find that the doctors will be talking to him more and more about his cancer and his treatment and what type of care he would like to get. The other thing, like even from Sharia perspective, when you look at this, this is someone who has serious illness. Now this serious illness may progress, and we know that there is also a chance that he may die. So there is a lot of things that he want to resolve before that. If he want to repent, if he want to go for tawbah, if he has any financial obligation, for example, debts or stuff that he would like to resolve before he died. All these things will not be resolved unless we have a clear communication about what is the disease, what are we dealing with, and what's the expectation. So I would encourage an open communication. As I told you, I think from psychological perspective, because then we allow the open communication and the person can talk about his feeling and his fear. It helps also the family in making the decision, because a lot of times when we don't have this clear communication, the family takes the burden of making the decision. And this burden, it may take them to the wrong direction, because they may go with more treatment that might not be quite beneficial, and it may cause more harm, thinking that we're providing him with the best care. So there is the psychological part, and then there is also the Islamic part, which is, we talked about, the living will and finances.
I think that there's one other component that I would appreciate the Imam giving us insight on, and that is, from an akhlaq perspective within Sharia, how does one balance giving hope versus sharing truth? Because the two are sometimes seen as incompatible when you're talking and giving truth about a life-threatening or very serious illness.
It's a really, really good question. In fact, I agree with what Dr. Ahmed said, because to be frank and to be transparent with the patient may give him some options for repentance, for Hajj, for Umrah, because everyone knows what he is indebted to. So I second what he said, that there should be transparency with the patient, but the approach itself, what I do recommend, the approach itself, it should be a good approach, someone with skills, physician with skills, to communicate with the patient in a good way, that he will tell the patient about everything, but in a very good way, because I agree with what Dr. Ahmed said. He may be need to repent from a serious sin that no one knows except him. And among the conditions of repentance, the return back to people, their rights. May he has taken someone's money with no rights. So transparency is very good in such a situation. But it's on the approach, the discourse that we, what we can speak about, and it's also may, yeah, there may be differences between cases. The answer may differ between cases and from one case to another, but transparency and to be frank with the patient is recommended in most cases.
Actually at the end, we've at 10:30, and I just wanted to thank our speakers for coming. I did have a request from someone who is an ICU physician who is in the audience who wanted to speak. I'm not sure if they're still here. Yes, so I'm not sure, would you like to come forward and say anything, or should I bring the mic to you?
I think I'm loud enough.
Okay, inshallah. So I'll let me just say a few words.
Here in the local area, and I actually struggle with this topic almost on a weekly basis now. I think our numbers are increasing, and unfortunately my knowledge is limited in this from an Islamic perspective, but the patient's knowledge is even, I found, even less than mine, which is already at all-time low. And I think that the significance for us as patients is to educate ourselves about this topic is paramount. But I also think that one of the things that I noticed, and in fact, I think maybe other people would agree, is that there's a lack of trust between the a lot of the, generally speaking, there is a lack of trust in the last few hours and days, because we are clinging into the person's life, and so my dad, I want to keep him alive, so generally anyone who's suggesting that that's not going to work out, I don't want to hear him or her. But I find that trust is even more profound among the Muslim families, unfortunately, towards non-Muslim physicians. The reality is the majority of the physicians in the ICU are not Muslim, are not people but they are very good people. So I think one of the first issues that I wanted to actually address is that we need to develop a rapport and a relationship between the physician in the ICU and our families. The other thing is, I think that we have to sort of become realistic about the expectations that we have. A few weeks ago, I took care of someone who was in multi-organ failure. Literally every organ is failing. And he actually had multiple cardiac arrests, one after another. And when we tried to explain to the family, you know, they essentially said, well, we're looking for a miracle. So I think that, you know, between looking for a miracle and being giving up, in between, Umar Khattab radiallahu anhu once entered a mosque and people were praying and reading the Quran, and he...
So this is the problem sometimes, that the palliative care has some bad connotation with some of the people. So with other specialties, so let's put it this way. We try to avoid this dichotomy where you're either being treated or you're palliative care and you're not treated. I know in the medical field, a lot of people, they have this understanding. And we're trying to divert away from this. We're not either treating you or you're not either being fully treated or palliative care. We're trying to divert away from this, okay? Or at least this is what I'm trying, this is what the field of palliative care physician trying to do. Because what we're trying to do, we're trying to provide the care along with other treatment. Now, the example that you're saying, you were talking about withdrawing treatment, not palliative care in general. Palliative care should not be only limited to when I draw your ventilator. It can be even started from before, okay? So the moment that he has the illness, why we're not providing him with palliative care? A lot of time there is the misnomer where it's been used as a way of describing withdrawal of treatment. And this is what I'm trying to educate people about, that palliative care is not about withdrawing treatment, it's a philosophy of care. Our aim here is really to focus on your quality and help you with the symptoms. Now, when you come to the decisions, sometimes where we're withdrawing or we're stopping ventilator, this is not palliative care only. This is like a description of the situation. Actually, the Rasuli case, unfortunately, which is known to you and Dr. Alibhai has mentioned it, one of the objections of the palliative care physician community that they use this, they used to describe the situation in this way, where they said patient should consent to palliative care. I don't want to confuse the audience here, but I think we have a lot of disagreement as a palliative care physician with describing the situation of withdrawing treatment as a palliative care, because this is not only limited to this. We should be providing our treatment and our intervention way before withdraw treatment.
Okay, so jazakallah for everybody for joining us today. I want to thank the speakers that we have come out. I know they've stayed quite late today as well, so if you could just give them a round of applause or thank them, inshallah. If you want these slides, they'll be posted on the MMAC website. and the audio, inshallah, will be posted on Masjid Toronto's website, their YouTube channel, as well as on the MMAC website, which is www.muslimmeds.ca. Okay, jazakallah.